Good morning and welcome to Highway Christian Fellowship Online. We are a church located in Sydney, British Columbia, right in between the airport and the ferry in beautiful Sydney by the sea. We are a church that simply loves God and loves people and invites you to join us on our journey to know God, find freedom, discover our purpose, and to make a difference in our world. We pray that today's message will encourage you and help you in your walk of faith. God bless, and let's enjoy the service together.
I will buy you a chocolate dip cone. Okay. I'm pretty hoping Sue didn't just hear that. Do you have your Bibles? Let me see your Bibles. Wave them way up. Oh, yes. Lord, thank you for your word. Turn in your word, in your Bibles, to Matthew chapter 6. And today, I am veering off the New International Version, and I'm going to a more traditional version that you will be familiar with, most of you will be familiar with, and you will understand why when we get to the scripture in Matthew chapter 6. But let me begin by asking you all a question. When you think about prayer, well, let me first ask you, do you ever think about prayer? You do. I think most of us do, don't we? And when you do think about prayer, think about your prayer life. Have you ever experienced and wished that your prayer life could be better at communicating with God? How many would say that's pretty true? I know I am. Have you ever felt like there were just times when your prayers were just hitting the ceiling and bouncing right back at you? Yeah? Helmet, yep. Do you ever wonder if there really is any power to your prayers? Well, I have good news to share with you this morning. But as you're looking at that scripture, let me tell you a story. Have you ever heard about the small Oklahoma town that had two churches and one distillery? Members of both churches complained that the distillery was giving the community a bad image. And to make matters worse, the owner of the distillery was an outspoken, godless atheist. He didn't believe in God. He didn't care about the things of God. He just wanted to make sure that people came to his distillery. Well, the church people had tried unsuccessfully to try to shut it down, so finally they decided to hold a joint Saturday night prayer meeting. They were going to ask God to intervene and settle the matter. The church folks gathered on Saturday night, and there was a horrible thunderstorm raging outside, and to the delight of the church members, lightning hit the old brewery and it burned to the ground. The next morning, the sermons that were preached in both churches were on the power of prayer. But the insurance adjusters promptly notified the distillery owner that they were not going to pay for the damages because the fire was an act of God. The distillery owner was furious, so what did he do? He sued both churches, claiming they had conspired with God to destroy his business. But the churches denied that they had anything to do with the cause of the fire. The presiding judge opened the trial with these words, and I quote, "I find one thing in this case most perplexing. We have a situation here where the plaintiff, an atheist, is professing his belief in the power of prayer. And the defendants, all faithful church members, are denying the very same power. It seems sometimes as Christians, we pray asking God to do certain things, either in our lives or in the lives of our family, only to be totally blown away when God actually answers our prayer. So, where do we start if it is our goal to establish a legitimate relationship and prayer life with God? If we go to any of our Christian bookstores or you go on Amazon, you will find there is a plethora of books out there talking about all kinds of different prayers and intercession, how to pray, how not to pray. How many can relate to this quote by apologist and teacher Lee Strobel when he writes, "I treated prayer as if it were a spiritual smorgasbord. I took a little of this author's ideas, a bit of advice from that pastor's sermon, applied some miscellaneous Bible verses, and mixed it with some counsel of well-meaning friends. The result? An imbalanced and half-baked prayer life that left me starving for something more satisfying." And I'm sure, and we don't have to raise our hands to this, but all of us would say amen to the statement, we all want a more satisfying and effective life of prayer. Well, we're not alone. Even the disciples had that desire. One day, Luke tells us in his gospel in chapter 11 that Jesus had been away praying. And upon his return, his disciples had a united question to ask him. We don't know which disciple that spoke up first. It may have been Peter, it may have been Andrew, but we're not sure. It doesn't really matter. But they spoke on behalf of the rest of the discipleship band, asking him this one question: Lord, teach us to pray. Now, these disciples had been raised as good Jewish young boys and men. They had gone to synagogue every Sabbath. They had recited the prayers written by Daniel and David and Moses and Job. They knew the kinds of prayers to pray to get God's attention. But these rote religious prayers were not cutting it for them. And so they look at Jesus and they see something different. They hear something different. They feel something different. There's something missing in their lives and in their relationship with God, and they want what their master has. Jesus, teach us to pray. Now, they could have asked for anything, couldn't they? They could have asked, Lord, teach us to preach. You are the supreme teacher, Jesus. Whenever you stand up, thousands come to hear you speak. Jesus, we want to speak like you. Teach us to preach. They could have asked him, Lord, teach us to do miracles. There's no one like you, Jesus, that can open blind eyes, cleanse the lepers, open the deaf ears, raise the dead. If we're going to change the world, people need to see the power of God, so teach us to heal. They could have asked him, Jesus, teach us the 10 easy principles of building a mega church. But of all the things they asked Jesus, the singular request was, Lord, teach us to pray. And so he wastes no time. And in chapter 6 of Matthew's gospel, Jesus says in verse 9, this is how you should pray. The New King James Version says, this is the manner to pray. Jesus does not give them the 1, 2, 3 secrets of an effective prayer life. Rather, he presents to them a model of prayer. A model is something we look at. That is our goal. That's what we want to include. That is our objective. This is the model for us to pray. and most of us here, have prayed this at one time or another. I remember being in school, and we prayed this after singing God Save the Queen and O Canada. Many of us have prayed this as part of our worship liturgy in church growing up. And I've used a particular translation that we'll all find familiar, because it's the translation I grew up memorizing it, the New King James Version. Could we stand and recite the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. This is Jesus' model prayer for his followers. There's nothing wrong in repeating this or reciting this verbatim. There's no reason to pray this. There are those who never pray until they're in danger, and the first prayer that they pray is this one. And there's nothing wrong with that. But Jesus doesn't want his disciples to be stuck in a rote modular prayer. Rather, he wants us to understand that prayer is a relationship with our Father who wants to lavish his love on his children. And as we look at these 7 points together in these verses, I want you to remember that as we come to prayer, we are coming to a Father. We are approaching a Holy Father who wants to lavish his love on you. He begins, "Our Father in heaven." The first thing I want you to underline is that word, "our." Prayer is not just a personal, individualistic exercise, but this prayer is meant to be prayed with all God's people. This is our model for prayer that Jesus gives us. This is for us together to come together in prayer before our Father in heaven. Because you see, our Father wants us to come and connect with him relationally. And not just relationally, but we are to call God our Father, that Jesus implies is his favorite title. He calls him Abba, which conveys that sense of intimacy. And he tells us to do the same. The word Abba is the Hebrew or Aramaic word, and it's similar to us coming to our earthly fathers and calling them Daddy or Dad or Papa. And for some of us, that makes us feel uncomfortable for a couple reasons. After all, he's a holy God. Why would we dare think we could come with an attitude of such intimacy? And that's how the disciples had been taught. That's what the religious leaders taught, that God was unapproachable by man because he was too holy, which is why we have the incarnation, which is why God came and took on flesh, which is why Jesus said, "When you have seen me, you've seen the Father." He calls us to come in intimacy, in relationship. How many can identify with this feeling and this testimony? How many of us, when your kids were little, or some of us still have those kids, or your grandkids, and they would, as soon as you came home from a hard day's work, was there anything that could heal you more and put a smile on your face when you would hear your kids shout, "Daddy's home! Daddy's home!" And how we long for those days when they would come running running from whenever they were and jump up into our arms and hug us for all it felt for eternity. And all of a sudden, those hugs just washed all the days and weeks blues away. My kids have long since passed those days, but now I have three wonderful grandchildren. When we come to visit them every couple months or so, when we drive in front of their house, they're there in the front window, and I can hear them from inside their house. Papa's here! Papa's here! And my oldest grandson will rush out of the house, and he'll jump up into my arms and say, "Papa, what did you bring me?" There is nothing that cheers our hearts more when we hear that, isn't there? In fact, it doesn't matter how old we get, how old I get, when I hear any of my kids text me and say, "Daddy," the entire world stops. In fact, I remember many years ago when Esther was still in college, she was attending St. Lawrence in the city of Belleville, and I was in Peterborough, about an hour or so away, drive away. And she texted me, and she was having a hard time in her first year of college. And I just saw those first words on my phone, "Daddy." All of a sudden, everything stopped. I canceled all of my appointments that afternoon. "Daddy, I'm not feeling well." All of a sudden, something took over me. My car supernaturally spun around, and it seemed like a nanosecond. I was there in Belleville at my sister's place, there to help my daughter with whatever she needed. Jesus says, when we come, and we jump on his knees. We come with bold confidence before the throne, where we receive help for every need we have. We come as his sons and daughters. As Paul tells us in Romans 8:15, "You have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba, Father." And after our Father in heaven, Jesus instructs us to take our relationship with our Heavenly Father even further. "Hallowed be your name." This is starting with worship. We worship his name. The word "hallow" means to revere, to bless, to honor. Basically, we are worshiping God's name. And when we pray, we need to know his name and to use his name. We find safety and security in hallowing his name. Proverbs 18, verse 10 tells us, it says in the Message, "God's name is a place of protection. Good people can run there and be safe." I want us to know, as we come to him, we are coming to a Father who has a name, and his name is powerful. His name is authority. We can trust his name. We have access to his name, to his authority, to his power. When we come to our Father, we come as his children. We can trust his word because our Father has the authority to grant what it is that we need. And we can trust his word and be safe and secure. There are so many of his names in the Bible. Let me just give you seven quickly. When you feel insecure about who you are in Christ, you can pray, "Jehovah Tsidkenu, for he is your righteousness." When we do not feel the strength to live for God and to move forward, remember to pray, "He is sanctifier." Are you facing a mental or physical or health challenge? He is healer. Do you ever wonder if you're on the right side when it seems the devil is winning so many social and moral battles? God is your banner for victory. Are you unsure of which direction to take in your life, in your career? God is your shepherd who leads you through even the dark and fearsome, lonely valleys to a green pasture filled with his provision. Are you anxious today? Are you fearful? He is your shalom, your peace. When there is more month at the end of the money, he is your provider. There are many other names and attributes of God for you to worship, and each one reflects part of God's gracious, holy character and reveals new aspects of your relationship with Father God. The Lord is more than worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. And once we've addressed our Father and worshiped him, Jesus tells us to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." This tells us that we need to pray our Father's agenda. And doesn't that make sense? After we've begun worshiping him, hallowing him, coming into his presence in a close, intimate relationship, doesn't it make sense that we would want to pray the Father's agenda? Because so often we like to jump to the next part of the prayer. We want, "God, give me, give me, give me, give me, give me." And then after you give me, "Give me, give me, give me, give me." No, before we do that, we pray, "Father, I love you. I can trust you. I know what you've done in my life. Lord, whatever it is you want me to do, Lord, I put your agenda first." Hallelujah. And what is his top priority and agenda? It's people. We studied that a couple weeks ago when Jesus came into the temple and he kicked out the money changers and the hypocrites from the courts, indicting them and reminding them that they had forgotten God's primary purpose for God's house, saying, "My house shall be called what? A house of prayer for all nations." People. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." His priority is people. We read throughout the Gospels that Jesus would be walking among the throngs of people and he would see the crowds and he would have compassion on them because he saw them as confused and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And he was moved to heal. He was moved to serve. He was moved because his priority from his Father was people. And he wants our hearts to ache for the people that are in our lives as well. And with our greetings and worship and focus on God established, Jesus then tells us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread." We can depend on him for everything. For everything. Say that with me. For everything. We can make known our petitions and express our dependence on him as the source of everything that we have and need. And when we pray, "Give us," we're acknowledging that God has everything we need. You know what I've noticed in my own prayer life and my own experience? That as I have put worship, as I have begun with worship, acknowledging that God is able, as I have committed myself to God's priorities, when I get to that place of praying, "Lord, give me my daily bread," you know what changes in my heart? My perspective of my needs. No longer are my needs my greeds, but they grow from greeds to needs. And when I see he provides his needs, he even bestows even more so that I can be generous and bless others. You see, he has everything we need. The psalmist expressed this kind of dependence when he said, "I look up to the mountains. Does my help come from there? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth, Psalm 121. We haven't been able to see it much this week, but behind the rain, the clouds, and the fog, there is this majestic mountain that we all know as Mount Baker. We can see it from almost anywhere on the island. We can see it when you go over to Vancouver. It is always there as this overarching, impending piece of creation that reminds us how great and awesome and big and powerful our God is. And just like Mount Baker is always there, our God even stands high above that mountain, and in Him we can find our trust and our help. Our help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth and Mount Baker. We depend on Him for everything. We praise Him as our source, for everything we have and everything we need comes from Him. Matthew 7, verses 9 to 11, Jesus says, "Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone, or if he asks for fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him?" I got good news for you, folk. God has some gifts for you, and they're good. They're good gifts. And he's just waiting for you to come and ask him. That's it. Some people ask, "Well, Pastor, I don't know what my gifts are. I don't know what God's given me." Have you asked him? It's just as simply, "Father, I need a bestowal of the good gifts of your Spirit in my life. I depend on you, and I make my requests known to you." You see, he does already know what we need. That's true. But we rely on him for our daily bread, because this not only keeps us humble, grateful, but secure in our faith, because we are ever placing our trust first in him. The next aspect of prayer Jesus instructs us, for many of us, is the hardest. It is confession. "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." He calls us when we come to make sure that we get our hearts right with both God and with others. I may be preaching a fuller message on this aspect of prayer in the days to come, but just let me point out a couple things that I felt Holy Spirit putting in my heart to share with you. There are some who come to God and they will say emphatically, "Yes, I know my sins are forgiven. I know Jesus died on the cross. I know Jesus shed his blood for me, and I know I'm going to heaven when I die, but you don't know, Pastor, what I have done. I can't forgive myself." When we come to God, our Father, through Jesus, in his name, and we say to him, "Lord, do you remember what I did? Do you remember what a dirty, rotten sinner I was?" Father says, "What? No." "Well, Father, just look at me." And as he does, he's looking at us. How is he looking at us? He's looking at us through Jesus, who is our righteousness. And we stand secure in him. And he does not bind us by our past. So why should we allow the past to bind us? Oh God, help us to let the past go. And then there are those who come to God and they would say, God, I know you've forgiven me. I know I am forgiven. But do you know what so-and-so did? God says, yeah, I know. And? What's the deal? I have forgiven you. And if I've forgiven you, then who are you not to forgive them? Oh, it's not easy. We'll talk about that in the next couple weeks, my friends. But I know it's not easy, and I don't want to be trite or simplistic. And even when we forgive others, the hurt and the pain and the anguish may be so deep. It doesn't mean that you're going to have restored relationships right away. But it does mean that that hurt and that pain and that bitterness will no longer have a hold on you. That's why we need to pray, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We need to make sure our hearts are right with both God and with others. For if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. And what? He will purify us from all unrighteousness. Some unrighteousness? A little bit of unrighteousness? He'll forgive us, yeah, but you know what you did over there? No, he'll forgive us all unrighteousness. And as we experience his forgiveness, we are called to extend that to those around us. Jesus calls us that we should pray and ask God to forgive us as we forgive others. I like what Chris Hodges says in his book, Pray First. And Pray First is a book that I have been reading throughout this series and has helped me a lot as I have been preparing. But I love this one quote from his book. Forgiveness keeps the line of communication open between you and God, as well as between you and other people. Two more points, and we'll be done. The next aspect of prayer Jesus instructs us is often confused by some people. He says, "Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." And I've heard it said, and I've had people ask me, Pastor, does that mean that God leads us into temptation? Of course not. Of course not. God does not lead us into temptation. He may allow us to face a trial or a temptation, but he does not actively tempt us. Some Bible scholars have argued that a better, more accurate translation of this verse would be, do not allow us to be led into temptation. Do you see the difference? We will face temptation. The enemy knows that too. And he'll be right there to cheer us on into it. And that's why we need God's help to resist and stand strong in our faith. Believe me, and don't make this mistake to think that the enemy does not care about you. Understand this. The enemy is always plotting, scheming, and working to bring about your downfall. So we are warned in 1 Peter 5:8, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. We call this spiritual warfare. Two words that unfortunately have been twisted to mean so many weird things. Some people even deny it's even necessary. But folk, if the Bible says that spiritual warfare is real, then we need to believe it and we need to understand what it's about. Prayer is first most communion with God, but it's also confrontation with the devil. Paul tells us in Ephesians 6:12, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. We confront the enemy by casting down every lie. Your dirt, your failure. God doesn't love you. Your husband doesn't love you. Your kids are lost. We bring Jesus' name. We bind the devil and his schemes and all of his schemes and plans against our family, our loved ones, our church, in Jesus' name. It means standing strong in the protective authority and power of our Heavenly Father. And when we pray, we take our stand against the enemy. And as we do, Jesus finally concludes where we began, by expressing faith in God's ability. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. If you have the New International Version, the ESV, and some more newer translations, that verse is missing from the King James and the older New King James Versions, primarily because those verses were not found in the earliest versions, Greek transcripts that have been discovered. But that does not mean that these words do not reflect the truth that Jesus and our Father has all power and all glory, and his kingdom shall reign forever and ever and ever. You see, God knows his ability. Some say, well, if God is all powerful, why do I need to pray? I'll tell you why we need to pray, because we need to know his power and authority and ability. Yours is the power. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory forever and ever. And as we end in worship, it is a catalyst for releasing our faith. I love these three phrases. Let's take a look at how each of these phrases references the attributes and our reasons for worshiping God. And worship team, you can return right now, because this is how we're going to conclude our service together. For yours is the kingdom. Jesus is saying all rule belongs to you, Father. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Yours is the power. Almightiness flows from you, Father. O sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you. Yours is the glory, Father. Your victory shall be complete. Revelation 5:13. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's stand and let's worship him with everything that we have this morning.